Today, I want to share with you some of my personal experience in the past almost 40 years in statistics, or almost all my life, I'm doing a clinical trial methodology. So if you read this word, translational statistics, this is a really interesting word. I don't think it's very popularized yet. The word translational statistics was actually introduced by one of my cardiologists in Brigham Women Hospital in Boston, Mark Pfeiffer. So he and I become a really good friend because I introduced his wife to him 7 years ago. So he owed me a lifetime. But of course, there is a risk, right? Maybe if they're having some problem, personal relationship, then I'm in trouble too. But in any event, he actually told me, say, why don't you patent this word, translational statistics? I don't know if he actually subscribed this website called Translational Statistics or not, but he's one of his lieutenants said that yes, he did. So I really like to share with you, we somehow live in the comfort zone these days. How can we stay out of the box, looking from outside to see what we can do? Can we do better job than we're currently doing? Is there anything actually exciting outside the box? I don't know, you guys are maybe too young to remember this really little book called Where's My Cheese? Have you heard about this book? Yeah. Where's the Cheese? Actually, it's a fascinating book. If you haven't read it, Google it, and you probably can get a free copy on the internet. That's basically just tell the mice, you know, how they don't stay in the same corner looking for the cheese. If you stay the same corner, someday the cheese is gone, you are in big trouble, okay? So I was started to put a slide together. Then this woman graduated from Harvard, and she went back to India, and a very nice lady, and somehow he became my friend through the Facebook, right? The Facebook, as you know, is really become a nuisance, right? Every day someone say, please give this guy, say, happy birthday, happy birthday. You know, they remind you three times, right, during the week. So become so annoyed. So I simply ignore my friend, Louise Ryan. Louise Ryan, if you got her Facebook, I wonder if she's actually doing anything serious or not, right? In any event, here is what this woman sent it to me. I find this fascinating. She said the first step towards getting somewhere is to decide that you are not going to stay where you are. But that's the kindergartens, right? Our teacher told us, right? But there's a lot of truth inside this phrase. So I really like to share with you today about 11 issues. You can come up with 20 issues later on after this seminar. So first, we ask ourselves, why do we stay in the comfort zone? And why are we doing things routinely, and we really don't want to get out of the box? If you know a lawyer, you know, my son is a lawyer. I also get involved in a few legal cases. The lawyers is a very interesting people. They actually follow the old pattern. So suppose you have a case, right, today in the court, and you actually can dig out an old case, 20 years old. There is some court in Wisconsin, somewhere out of nowhere, and the court decide in favor of your similar case, your case. You actually can bring that case and bring to the court, argue, say, 20, 30 years ago, the court decided this way. So I think you guys should follow. So the law practice, they always want to do conventional. And if you are legal, the so-called expert witness, it's really funny. If you say, hey, listen, Mr. So-and-so, I have a novel statistical procedures I'd like to propose to you. We can reanalyze this data for you for legal case. He said, no, don't say this word novel. Because novel in the court means not very good. So they wanted to know it's routinely used, commonly used, okay? So that's the mentality of our legal system. So in some way, if you notice, in our profession, we design a trial, we have a protocol to put together, right? Did you notice the protocol almost looks identical? It's sort of like cut and paste, just changing the words. Statistical part is very similar, right? So why do we do this? I think there is obviously a reason, right? If I work in the industry, for example, if I say, hey, my boss to my boss say, I have some better idea. So the, my boss is very kind to me, say, okay, why don't you try it? So suppose this new idea doesn't work, then what are you gonna do? Everybody blame you, right? But if you stay in the box and do the old same thing, if you failed, your boss say, don't worry, we just have a bad luck, right? So most of us, including myself, we don't want to actually walk out the box looking at ourselves. Basically also, delay the review by FDAs or medical journals, right? If you have some novel idea, FDA say, we don't understand it, right? So you have to take a long time to explain to those guys. So let me just state this one single sentence. What is really the goal of a clinical study? What is our job, right? And this is all loaded. The words are all loaded in this simple, very simple sentence. I say use efficient and reliable procedures to obtain the robust, clinically interpretable results with respect to risk-benefit perspectives at the patient level. Wow. You think it is a simple sentence? Actually, it's very hard to get there, right? It's actually reflecting what we're doing every day. We try, but unfortunately, most of us, we, including myself, we didn't. So clinically, how to explain to people about area under the curve up to 40 months? So here is the, in this study, the area under the curve is up to 40 months is 35.4 for the low dose, and 33.3 is high dose. So how do I explain to people 35.4? That means in the future, if you're treating the patient with low dose, and on average sense, those guys are going to survive 35.4 months. But if you're treating by high dose, they survive 33.3. So the difference is 2.1 months. You think this is small individually, but remember this is the averaging sense. Okay, the p-value in this case is 0.04. Wow, you know, this is a wonderful example from 0.48 to 0.04. No matter, you know, who actually said, wow, they're jumping up and down, right? So my the moral of the story, just saying, the hazard ratio is heavily modeled because you're assuming the proportional hazard assumption. We know very few cases this is happening, except for the case you follow the patient very short. You know, the survival curve is still split, and you're never going to see the longer follow-up. You know, fortunately or unfortunately, we're all going to heaven, right? So if you follow the patient long enough, what do you think about your Kaplan-Meier curve? Two curves are going to go together anyway. So proportion hazards of assumption never true. Even Sir David told me in public also, he said, you guys just use the proportion hazards so much, I feel a little embarrassed. I said, why? He said, the proportion hazards model is mathematically very attractive, but in practice, never happen. So he even encouraged us to think about a linear model with a log scale called accelerated failure time. So my advice, my suggesting to all of us, why don't we try some model free? And Cyrus actually is a good friend. He started to trying. He said, oh, this is not too bad, right? After I know him about, 30 years? Yes? This is another one I want to just mention one that I quit. Okay, I apologize.
No, we have a break, we just short.
Oh, sorry about that. So this one actually is really, really important to us. You know, every diabetes drug, if you want to push in the market, first they ask you to do efficacy trial. Efficacy trial is relatively small, a few hundred patients. What is outcome for that patient? For the A1C level, right? You control A1C, the sugar level, you're okay. But FDA always want the people doing CV study, safety study, cardiovascular, for large trials, okay? So here's one example. This one trial is, this trial is your trial or Takeda's trial or, oh no, this is not, this is Takeda's trial? Okay. This is actually close to home, Cyrus was facing So this is actually the Takeda's diabetes drug. After they got approved, they said, FDA said, go do a trial, a large trial. So they got about 6,000 patients, I believe, right? Some total, right? So towards the end, look at this Kaplan-Meier's curve, or the 1 over 1 minus. They totally overlapped, okay? So let's look at this confidence interval here. The upper confidence is 1.16. That means the hazard ratio is no more than 16%, right? Then FDA is somehow, someone put up 1.3 as a threshold. If it's less than 1.3, FDA said you're okay. It's above 1.3, then you're dead, right? So one time I asked people, say, who actually pick up a 1.3, right? 1.3 is so arbitrary because your event rate is so low, 1.3 is too strong assumption. But if your event rate is so high, 1.3 probably is too loose, right? They said, well, because of Tom Fleming and this, who else in the Cleveland Clinic?
Steve
Neeson. Those two guys in some other committee meeting, they said, let's pick up 1.3, okay? So we have to.
2 and one said 1.4 and then they
take average. So you see, this is interesting. We have two people decide our future, right? So then we find out it's a very interesting phenomenon. If you use a hazard ratio to use a confidence interval upper bound 1.3 as a threshold, right? Now remember, the confidence interval of hazard ratio heavily depend on what? The total number of events. If you have thousands of patients without an event, you are dead because they say you have no information. But think about it, in the safety trial, if you have two arms, you follow the patient very long and no events at all, do you think that's good news? Yeah. Everybody agree, right? Every time I said it to people, say, yes, this is good news. No news is good news. But FDA said, no, you can't. You need some events to help me out. I said, this is really dumb. Because you don't take exposure time into consideration for hazard ratio. So that's ridiculous, right? So then they said, what's your alternative? I said, use area under the curve of Kaplan-Meier's. And turns out, if you use area under the curve, you can actually reduce the size to 1/3 of the exam, this trial, and without losing any clinically meaningful difference at all. So you cannot say, my area under the curve difference is a statistically more efficient way, but this guy has a clinical interpretable, right? The difference of two restrict the mean survival time, right? If you don't have any events, 0 minus 0, I say, I close the door, I say, bye, bye, right? I mean, this is great news, right? So we are in the process of convincing FDA, and the Eli Lilly folks is really interesting. I think, Cyrus, you have a friend, this is consortium, right? Industry consortium stuff. Eli Lilly, the anti-diabetes drug people, they have five CV trials going on. They said, LJ, if we can convince FDA using this idea, we can save billion dollars. He said, you should charge Eli Lilly by percentage of their savings. I know Merck. I know Merck is going to disclose this one trial in London. I think this week, probably. I tell you. I told Mark Pfeiffer, he is a PI, I said, Mark, put this in the SAP before you're unblinded. He did. He actually asked one of his statisticians, my former student, and put this piece in the trial, in the SAP. Just in case your upper bound is 1.31, boy, the Merck is going to down the hill, right? I mean, of course, I mean not. You have another trial is going on, so what, improve it? It's still going on right now? You know, Okay. Kiefer, I have to apologize. I'm going to have a conference call with investor tomorrow talking about improvement. They're going to predicting what is the outcome for improvement. So if I can predict well tomorrow, we can bring you with a charter flight to Hawaii next, we have this meeting here, right, okay? I'm not going to bore you with the meta-analysis. This is also another issue. Stephen Neeson made a bigger case against Avandia. Turns out that Avandia is okay. So this is a really sad, long story. So let me just share what I'm saying here. So, you know, it's funny, we're still teaching the student every day. We said, hey guys, we have one data set is normally distributed, then what is the best way to estimating the mean? Or the guy say, oh, mean is X bar. I said, why do you use X bar? Oh, because it's a minimum variance unbiased estimator. I said, well, and compare two groups, what are you gonna do? Oh, I'm gonna use a t-test, maybe a Coxon test, whatever it is. Model never be correct. Model just approximation. We assume is model correct. We teach our students so well what is optimal solution for a wrong problem. Somehow we don't get an approximate solution to a right problem. That's what George Box always telling us when I was a student. I didn't listen to him at all 40 years ago. So I suffered for 30 years. Right? So I really like to share with you again by repeating George Box saying, look, how can we learning from engineering's concept? Engineering, those guys, they don't have like 100% perfect, like not like a mathematician. 80% chance the Airbus were flying, they, oh, that's okay, right? So how can we actually make a coherent story from the beginning, phase one to phase three, and even in the post-marketing? Instead, every time we say something, say, oh, your model is correct, I do lack of fit test. Lack of fit test, you got a p-value 0.10, you're jumping up and down, say, model is correct. Everybody knows that's the BS, right? I mean, forgive me my French, right? So it's about time. I really think we should think about the whole thing as a package deal, right? Teaching the student a case study, not only teaching them a fragmentary, piece by piece, glue them all together, can we actually helping us each other? So the last bullet is very important. Max Helpring was a famous biostatistician at NIH many years ago. He died when I was teaching at George Washington University. I became a very good friend of Max. He actually taught me just one sentence. He said, LJ, every time you face a problem, you ask yourself, what is the question? Okay, different question, you have a different approach, different solutions. I didn't understand what he was saying. He also told me one thing I really appreciate. He said, LJ Wei, don't getting old. If you're getting older, you'll have all kinds of problems. Now, I appreciate that piece very well. But on the other hand, I like to share with you, what is the question? You think that's a simple question? It's not a really simple question, okay? So I close up here, sorry for this delay. Thank you very much.